It's a proven fact that California has some of the highest statistics in the nation when it comes to gang violence, gang-related homicides, and other violent crimes committed by active gang members. Per capita, the numbers are astonishing. In fact, the problem is so prevalent and widespread that the Golden State is often referred to as the nation's gang capital. At the center of this internecine culture lie two criminal organizations that essentially control the stout majority of Hispanic street gangs and their following: the Nuestra Familia, NF, and the Mexican Mafia, M.A. Both of these criminal organizations evolved within the California prison system and have remained entangled in a deadly rivalry that has lasted for more than six decades. With tens of thousands of willing gang members at their disposal, these two groups are responsible for thousands of murders that were committed both in prison and on the streets. I was a member of the Nuestra Familia. I'm sure that when this book is released for publication, it will invite a wide arena of personal critics, and a number of people who knew me are going to be extremely disappointed that I ultimately chose to do this. Honestly, I understand this. After having muddled away almost 20 years of my life, serving as a loyal, dedicated member of the Nuestra Familia, someone who steadfastly advocated and promoted for the very things that I am now exposing. There's definitely a measure of hypocrisy and raw contemptuousness for my writings, but I feel completely remorseless and unsympathetic about everything that I'm about to say. I only ask that you, the reader, defer from passing any judgment about me or what I've done until this book has been read in entirety. It took close to 5 years of legal wrangling and a continuous flow of adversity to push me in the direction to finally write this book. But I can tell you now that I have absolutely no regrets and firmly believe that I made the right choice. In the beginning, these choices came with much restraint, as I was often impeded with a fake sense of honor. But in the end, I made these choices freely. My purpose for writing this book wasn't to use it as a sounding board to blackwash, ridicule, or slander the Nuestra Familia, but instead to provide transparency and expose the drudgery, charades, a fractured cause, and the rampant corruption that has now become its own fertile enemy. It's an opportunity for me to tell the unscripted story of my own personal journey, what I endured, and the ill-fated path I ultimately chose. It's an open-ended description about how I rose to the top of one of California's most violent criminal organizations, and how I fell in the face of flawed politics, personal agendas, and self-serving, unethical motivations. This is an inside look at how self-delusional, naked greed and a cannibalistic organization lost sight of its purest fundamentals and entrenched itself in a heightened state of paranoia. This book is not about self-glorification or self-embellishments. The stark brutality of what took place should serve as a deglamorization of the gang philosophy and the perilous lifestyle I lived. Everything you read in this book was derived from first-hand accounts, either through my own experiences or through investigative research compiled from legal documents, courtroom testimony, police reports, debriefing reports, published news accounts, and a collaboration of interviews by law enforcement agents, prosecutors, defense attorneys, relatives, and confidential informants. The narrative is consistent and accurate. When I decided to write this book, I wanted it to be written so that the reader could somewhat relate and form an undiluted and accurate percipience of what the Nuestra Familia honestly represents. I wanted to simplify this story so that the average reader who has no prior knowledge of this organization could form their own analogies based on other criminal organizations. I didn't want to complicate the storyline by interjecting the plethora of insignificant verbiage such as the organization's guidelines, governing tautology, or lengthy constitutions, so I kept it as concise and as compendious as I possibly could. I've read quite a few crime books in the past about guys who defected and described their own experiences, but in some of those books, I got the impression that they tried to over-glorify themselves or paint themselves out to be something more than what they really were. Not wanting to sound overly critical, I commend and praise them all for their writings. However, I hope that you, the reader, and those who know me, do not make similar comparisons or the same analysis about me. I'm sure those still active or associated with this movement will read this book with preconceived opinions about me, but one thing I can promise you is this: everything I reveal will ring true. their conscience will secretly agree and relate to some of the things that I have laid out. To deny this would only suggest that they continue to be willing victims of the organization's pretentious smokescreens. The manipulation exists and continues to remain prevalent and commonplace within the Western familia today. One can only submerge himself in a blind state of perpetual denial and look the other way for so long. Eventually, the ill-boding truth will catch up to them. I know what I'm talking about because I wallowed in this muddy cesspool for almost 20 years. In this diabolical game, reality, or the unambiguous truth, only seems to become transparent when the O organization turns its fury on you, or it's you who becomes the ill-fated victim of the O's afflictions. This seems to be the only way that some of us are rattled and shaken out of these abstracted walking comas that the O has us under. Initially, when I dedicated my life to this movement and swore a blood oath to these supposed brothers in crime, it was because I felt that it was for a righteous cause, something I genuinely believed in. The NF fought for freedom, equality, and servitude from other prison gangs, and this was something I strived to be a part of. Over the years, I was transformed into a stalwart believer, and the NF fire burned strong in my heart. I believed in the NF philosophy wholeheartedly, and I was committed to fighting for what I thought was a well-founded purpose. I glorified everything about the existence, the violence, the drugs, the fast money, the women, the status, the recognition, the influence, and especially the prestige of the entire subculture. It became second nature. I lived it, breathed it, walked it, and talked it. As the adage goes, I gave them my mind, body, and soul. I never imagined that I'd ever write a book like this, or that I'd ever undertake the position that I have today. It's still mystifying and perplexing when I gather myself to think about it. But then again, I never thought I'd be subjected to the misgivings and the level of betrayal that I encountered either. Once my standing and status became inherently clear, and I realized that I had fallen out of graces with the NF, I reluctantly defected and agreed to become a cooperating witness for the state. For me, there was no gray area here. I was going to fully cooperate with law enforcement and take my life in another direction. Initially, I struggled with my predicament and actually considered spending the rest of my life in prison. It just wasn't that easy turning my back on the people who I consider to be my brothers. The alter ego boxer continued to fight and grapple with this undesired transition. Regardless of whether or not I was in good standing with the NF, my resolve was aimed at not giving these people the luxury or satisfaction of seeing me break or going out ass backwards. That's all that mattered to me. My options were clear. I could either salvage what little bit of integrity I maintained as a man by taking a life sentence and spend the rest of my life in prison in bad standings anyway, or I could try to help myself by cooperating, changing my life, and accept the fact that I was going to be in bad standing no matter which way I rolled. The wise choice was obvious, but I still needed something to give me that final push. For me, it just took time. I had to reevaluate my priorities and how I wanted to live out the rest of my life. I was obviously expendable, and this realization resigned me. It humbled me, but it also hurt me in the worstest way possible. I had sacrificed 20 years of my life only to be discarded and tossed to the side like a piece of trash. This was the turning point for me. I officially called it quits and defected from the familia in late December 2007. But it was a decision I knew would literally change my entire life, one that carried ominous consequences. But it was a decision I was willing to make, a decision that would clearly overshadow any other choice I had ever made in my life. My biggest struggle was compromising my integrity and becoming an informant. That was what I struggled with. Even after seeing how swiftly their loyalty to me vanished, it still hurt me to turn my back on some of these people that were about to become the victims of my discomfiture. Turning snitch contradicted everything I believed in as a man. Principles, ethics, scruples, integrity, honor, dignity, and loyalty were all part of my own belief system that would now have to be compromised and called into question. These were traits I believed in long before I even knew the Nuestra Familia existed, and now I was being forced into making these kinds of choices. They say there's no honor amongst rats and snitches, and this may be true, but for me it's not about being a rat or any false sense of honor. Honor by whose standards? Society surely doesn't live by these standards, nor is this how they define honor. This is the NF's belief system, which is ostracized and rejected by the norms of real society. So why should I continue to apply myself to these standards any longer if I have removed myself from this organization? For me, this was about a nobler calling and a real opportunity to change my life. That's it. That's all. Now that I have removed myself from this cutthroat organization and the criminal element, I've begun a new journey towards redemption. I feel a sense of liberation and so removed from the man I used to be, boxer from San Francisco. Today, I'm just John Mendoza. I no longer desire the notoriety or sway I once commanded. This is no longer the type of attention or reverence I once craved. I've detached myself from the man I used to be. This transformation continues today. I have taken the first couple of steps and believe my life is now headed in the right direction. But there is no instant metamorphosis. It's a process. I wish it was that easy. In many ways, I feel like I'm experiencing a rebirth, almost like I'm in the embryonic stages of becoming a better person, as if I'm undergoing a thorough cleansing of all my demons. The feeling is enriching. I feel like I have a real purpose now, as if society will accept me for who I have become, and I'm committed to fulfilling this quest. Now, I know that the NF will ostracize me for writing this book, and I will forever be a marked man, but I'm okay with that, and I have accepted this reality. I've weighed all these things out in my mind, but my walk towards redemption is more important. I spent too many years of my life living in an animalistic way, desensitized by violence. I no longer desire to live a life entrenched in criminal politics or the duplicity that the Western familia nurtures. I want normalcy. Normalcy. That's all I want. I hope this book provides some real transparency and insight into the impoverished and poorly educated young minds who glamorize gang life and all those who continue to glamorize the NF. This subculture has created an epidemic affecting our youth and infecting our youth and poisoning their minds. However, collectively, we can make a difference and narrow the gap. Hopefully, this book succeeds in changing somebody's life and prevents them from falling victims to the same mistakes I made. If only one individual life is touched by this book, then I have accomplished my goal. I have the strangest feeling that the majority may not understand how this atmosphere they foster nurtures a mindless, hopeless mass. The reality is sad, but this is the life they continue to gravitate toward, and this is the life that will surely lead them to a perilous and dreadful end.